Mondstadt, nation of freedom, wind, songs, and evergreen fields. Protected by the gentle winds of the animal ark in Barbados, it is a place that many happily call home. But it wasn't always like that. In fact, old Mondstadt was an inhospitable land of snow, ice, and frigid winds. So much so that in the far past, an ancient civilization that resided in it felt the need to seek refuge elsewhere. And they found it in a mountain they called Vindagnir, which was full of greenery and the bounties of nature. They established themselves in the peak of this mountain and called their kingdom Selvindagnir. And they lived happily, for a while anyway. After all, their kingdom was a prosperous one, and it is possible that they even had direct contact with celestial envoys. Within this kingdom there was a silver white tree of great significance. One day, a princess was born under this tree and blessed with the ability to see the future. The king and his people were overjoyed at this. Such a gift surely denoted favor from the gods. Except, the princess saw terrible things lying ahead. She dreamed of a black dragon that blotted out the sun and took this dream to be a bad omen. It was around this time that Celestia's favor was revoked, and instead of sending down envoys, they sent the Skyfrost snail, which destroyed the great silver-white tree as it fell. This snail later split into three parts, covering Vindagnir and unending ice. To this day, this mountain remains encased in ice and is now known as Dragonspine, though this black dragon would not come for many centuries yet. It is unknown why Celestia sought to destroy Selvindagnir, but it is possible the princess had stumbled into forbidden knowledge. One way or another, destroy it they did. The changes in their environment were too much for the people of this kingdom to bear, and eventually they all died out. The only survivor there are records of is Imunlocker, an Outlander who had spent some time in Selvindagnir and grown close to the princess. After the Skyfrost snail fell, he left in an attempt to find a way to save the nation, only to find everyone dead when he returned. Little is known of the rest of his life, but he went on to create the Imunlocker clan, which would, centuries later, be one of the founding clans of Mondstadt we know today, alongside the Genhildr and Loras clans. As for the rest of what is now Mondstadt, we know there were civilizations scattered around, as we can still find the ruins of their monuments today, like Cecilia Garden or the Midsummer Courtyard. However, we don't have enough information to establish a timeline until the Arcan War began an undisclosed amount of millennia ago. What we do know is that the Caribbean, also known as the God of Storms, who possessed the power of Animo, eventually made himself king, officially creating Mondstadt and establishing his capital city in what is now known as Storm Terra's Lair. Around the same time, Andres received his power from an ancient god, ascending to godhood himself. Soon, both him and the Caribbean were locked in a war, except the Caribbean would rather endure a siege than fight head-on. As a result, he retreated with his people to his capital city and sealed it off with a wind barrier that shielded them from Andres' blizzards. However, this barrier not only prevented Andres from entering, but also his people from leaving. While the records we have make it seem like the Caribbean truly cared for his people, amidst restricting their freedom and his controlling nature, it did not take long for the humans under his care to start seeing him as a tyrant. Because of this, 2,600 years ago, the Genhildr clan, to which acting Grandmaster Jin belongs, decided to leave the capital city and try their luck out in the desolate and icy wilderness. However, this turned out to be a tougher endeavor than they had anticipated, and in their desperation, they prayed for help. Fortunately for them, these prayers were answered by a tiny wind spirit that was able to shield them and grant them a safe haven. This clan's worship and faith, in turn, allowed the spirit to grow stronger. Still inside the wind barrier, the winds of resistance were starting to pick up. Unhappy with their situation, a nameless bard, his close friend, the wind spirit who had protected the struggling Genhildr clan, Hamas, a woman who was a lover of the Caribbean, a knight and a wandering red-haired warrior formed the rebellion and rallied the people to their side. The Genhildr clan joined them in their fight, perhaps out of gratitude to the wind spirit. Meanwhile, Andreas had come to realize that his blizzards prevented life from prospering. Knowing that he was unfit to rule humanity as the Animal Archon, he willingly chose to die, leaving his physical form behind. When exactly this happened and why the Caribbean did not dispel his barrier is unclear. What is clear, though, is that the rebels went to war against their tyrannical god. And they won. The Caribbean died. But at a terrible price. Many people died as well, Amos and a nameless bard included. With the people's faith in him becoming stronger than ever, the wind spirit ascended to godhood and became Barbatus, the Animal Archon. Still grieving for his bard friend and wishing to honor him, Barbatus took on his friend's form, which he still maintains to this day. Though peace and freedom had been obtained, Mondstadt was still a land of desolation, so Barbatus took it upon himself to completely terraform the icy mountainous terrain into what we know today. Fun fact, Pylos Peak was a huge mountain that used to exist in Mondstadt. It was so imposing that an adventurer named Leonard, the man who went on to create the wind glider, spent a large portion of his life trying to reach the summit, only to die without achieving his dream. And this is what is left of Pilot's Peak once Barbados was done with it. Yeah, let that sink in. It was also around this time that a young and naive Valen descended on Mondstadt, accidentally scaring the people. But Barbados wasn't scared and instead sang him a song. After that, he and Valen became fast friends. Now that the new Mondstadt was established, Barbados refused to actively rule over it, as it would contradict his ideal of freedom. And thus, he slumbered away while peace reigned in his nation. For about 1,000 years, because good things never last. You see, after Barbados went into his slumber, Mondstadt's rule fell into the hands of the aristocrats, namely the descendants of the Moonlocker, Genhilder, and Lawrence clans that I mentioned previously. And at first, everything was okay. The aristocrats were good to the common people. They held festivals like the Ludiar Bastem and Windbloom for their enjoyment and treated them fairly. And they took Barbados' ideals seriously. It was around that time that Venerare, then leader of the Lawrence clan, ordered the original statue of Diana Morgan be built. Yes, original. She and the heads of the other clans also had an oath to defend the Mondstadt be inscribed in the statue's base. The statue would eventually be destroyed during the later stages of the aristocracy, having been built again after it came to an end, but the original oath was lost. But time passed, and around 1,000 years later, everything just started to go wrong. It was at this point that Ursa the Drake began his long reign of terror over the Land of Freedom, terrorizing not only the city itself, but also the plains where the nomadic tribe Vanessa was born into lived, which forced their people to flee and seek refuge in Mondstadt City. Roughly at the same time, the Moonlocker clan fell off the records and the Lawrences became the most influential clan among the aristocracy. Unfortunately, it did not take long for the power to get to their heads, and they soon became tyrants, enslaving anyone who they deemed to be a threat, including Vanessa's clan, and they also started to treat the people very poorly, even going as far as to rig the festivals. This is a time period covered by the prologue of the manga, and in it we see newly awakened Barbados was ascended to free his people, experiencing firsthand the farce that the Ludiar Bastem festival has become. He introduces himself as Venti, a simple bard, and it's under this guise that he meets Vanessa, a slave of an unnamed clan who is forced to fight as a gladiator to earn his people's freedom back. However, they don't meet under the best circumstances. During the Ludiar Bastem festival, Barca Lawrence, heir of the Lawrence clan, went against tradition and claimed both the Arpastem Ball and the Arpastem Maiden for himself, very much against their will, might I add. And it wasn't even the first time, he had already done the same for the past 4 years. Horrified at this and unable to see his people suffer, Venti takes Arpastem Ball for himself, while thinking, "Your reign of greed ends here, porkling," which has to be one of the best things I've ever read. After teasing a young Barca, Venti takes off running, which is when he accidentally runs into Vanessa. When Barca catches up, Venti does the single most brave act anyone has ever done in the history of ever and cowers behind Vanessa, who stands up for him. This angers Barca even further, leading him to ask his father to buy not only Vanessa, but her entire clan. As a result, she is thrown in jail and told she has one last duel to fight and that, should she win, she and her people can go free. However, knowing better than to trust the Lawrences, Venti tries to break her out of jail, but Vanessa has too much responsibility riding on her shoulders and declines. She will stay and fight. Little did she know that Lord Lawrence, master of the city, had struck a deal with Ursa the Drake, and so, the next day, Vanessa and her entire clan were thrown outside the city walls to fight the very creature that had driven them into the city to start with. It wasn't a duel, it was a sacrifice. However, in his arrogance, Lord Lawrence claimed that, should Vanessa win, he would hand all of his property and the city keys to her. Knowing it was a battle she could not win, Vanessa instructed her people to run for the city walls, only for them to be shot down by the archers perched on them at Lawrence's command. Even though she was stuck between a rock and a hard place, Vanessa refused to go down without a fight. But it was hopeless. Until Barbados came to save the day. Using the power of Animo to guide Vanessa's sword, he helped her strike Ursa the Drake, who fled the fight. After that, Venti forced Lord Lawrence to keep his word and give Vanessa's property. And so, Vanessa's rebellion started, aided by many like the Ragvinder, and the aristocracy was eventually dispelled, with everyone who supported it having been exiled. After that, Vanessa created the Knights of Favonius and became his first headmaster. Barbados implemented the Four Winds and entrusted the safety and protection of Mondstadt to them in his absence. They were made up of the Dragon of the East, or Dvalin, Wolf of the North, or Andreas, the Lion of the South, a position held by the Grand Masters of the Knights of Favonius, and the Falcon of the East, who is believed to be Vanessa after she ascended to Celestia. And so, Mondstadt enjoyed roughly 500 more years of peace, which brings us to the birth of Rosalind Kruschka Lohfalter. It was originally a normal girl who fell in love with a knight of Favonius named Rostam. Eventually, these two lovers had to part ways as Rosalind traveled to Sumeru to study at the academia, with the promise of returning to Rostam. However, that promise could never be fulfilled, as a cataclysm broke while she was away. During that time, Mondstadt was overrun by monsters and Durin, one of Rhine's daughter's creations, and the dragon was coming the Princess of Sovindagnir had foreseen millennia ago. Durin's mind was clouded and he did not have a correct perception of reality. While he believed to be making friends and having fun, he was actually laying waste to Mondstadt. In order to protect his land and his people, Barbatus called on Dvalin to help him fight Durin. Dvalin and Durin fight, with Durin's body coming to rest on what was once Vindagnir and finally putting the Dragonspine in Dragonspine. His blood was able to revitalize the great silver-white tree that had been destroyed by the Skyfrost Nail so long ago, and it's the same tree that, after being fed enough crimson agates, becomes the frost-bearing tree. However, during their fight, Dvalin ingested some of Durin's poisonous blood, which made him ill. In order to recuperate, Dvalin retreats to the Caribbean's old tower back in Old Mondstadt and falls into deep slumber. At some point around this time, we know that Barbatus and the other original six Archons were involved in Kanria, but the exact timeline isn't clear. What we do know is that the gods weren't the only ones that traveled to Kanria. The Knights of Favonius also organized an expedition, which Rostam was a part of. He would never return. After the cataclysm, Barbatus eventually returns to slumber and Rosalind returns to Mondstadt to discover her lover had died in her absence. Consumed by grief, she allows liquid fire to course through her veins, becoming the Crimson Witch of Flames so that she might burn away the crookedness of this world. However, before her flames can burn out, Piejo, first of the Fatui Harbingers, finds her and gives her a cryo delusion that subdues her flames. And so, La Signora is born. Fast forward roughly 500 years, 4 years before the events of the game take place, and there's still one certain dragon causing problems, Ursa the Drake. During Diluc's 18th birthday, he and his father, Crippus, are traveling on a caravan when the Fatui use metal bugs that emit the aroma of the mist flower to lure Ursa. In the ensuing fight, Crippus uses his illusion to protect his son, driving the dragon away but losing his life in the process. This, however, was not the Fatui's original plan, so they lure Ursa back shortly after so the Tote can kill him and gain leverage in the nation, finally allowing the Fatui to spread their reach to Mondstadt and giving the doctor a way to acquire test subjects in the form of children. One more dragon down, but because that's one too little, it's finally time for Dvalin to wake up. And he does so with a terrible mood. Between the poisonous blood that ran in his veins for 500 years, the fact that the people of Mondstadt had forgotten him, and the Beast Order whispering in his ear, Dvalin starts attacking Mondstadt, earning him the moniker Storm Terror, which, since he was still living in Old Mondstadt, made the citizens of the City of Freedom rename that location to Storm Terror's lair. Wanting to help his old friend, Barbatus wakes up once more. He manages to talk to his draconian friend, but is interrupted by a certain traveler. And the rest is history. Hi everyone! I did not think this video would require as much research and time as it did, or even as many takes while recording. Turns out compiling everything into a cohesive timeline is no easy task. I did revise this multiple times, and hopefully everything is accurate, but if you find any mistakes, let me know in the comments down below. Anyway, if you enjoyed, please consider giving this video a like and hitting the subscribe button because it helps a lot. For now, that is all, but my name is Blue, and I'll see you again soon. Safe journey, travelers!